Christ. My name is Hisham Shahab. I am the pastor and missionary at Salam Christian Fellowship and another also national mission society I founded called Messiah for Muslims, a recognized service organization of the Missouri Synod, Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. I welcome you to this session of our update on Salam ministry. And I have with me here Mr. Muayyad from Iraq. He'll tell us about the social services we do at Salam and Messiah for Muslims. أهلا وسهلا فيك مؤيد، شكرا لحضورك معنا اليوم. فيك تخبرنا كيف جيت على أمريكا أو عن عائلتك وإلى آخره.
عائلتي جت إلى أمريكا من أكثر من 10 سنوات.
My family came 10 years ago to America.
والدتي وأختي وأولادهم.
My mother and my sister and their children as well. So after some years, they applied for me and I was able to come to the United States 2 years ago. Almost 2 years ago. شو هاللي خليكم تجوا على كنيسة السلام؟ شو الشيء اللي
كنيسة السلام معروف عنها تقدم مساعدات لكل الجاليات العربية والغير العربية.
We came to Salam Christian Fellowship because Salam offers services to Arabs and non-Arabs as well, from North Africa as well. And this really drew us to come to Salam Christian Fellowship. So they offer social services unconditionally, irrespective of the race and color or religious belief of the people who come. And I am one of those individuals who came and benefited from those social services. Salam was able to help me through taking me to clinics, hospitals, public administrations, and even sometimes if we fall short for a bill or rent, Salam is able to help a little bit with that. شو هاللي بتشعروا لما تيجي على كنيسة السلام؟
أشعر بالمحبة والسلام.
So when I come to Salam Christian Fellowship, I feel love and peace. And Salam is peace. So
لأن التعامل بإنسانية.
Because they deal with us in a very humanitarian way.
بغض النظر عن دينك أو أي شيء آخر.
Irrespective of our religion or beliefs. هل بتدعي غيرك يجي على كنيسة السلام؟
أشجع كل شخص إذا كان محتاج لمساعدة أو أي شيء آخر باللجوء لكنيسة السلام.
I really encourage people to come to Salam Christian Fellowship irrespective of what they do or they believe because they'll find love and peace. رح أسألك هلا شو تعلمت عن المسيح بغض النظر سواء أنت بتآمن فيه أو لا، هذا شيء موضوع شخصي لإلك. فكنيسة السلام شو تعلمت منها أشياء مفيدة؟
تعلمت
لأنه أنت بتحضر العظة وبتحضر درس الكتاب فبصورة منتظمة.
دين محبة وسلام.
So I learned that Christianity is a religion of love and peace and cooperation with others.
نعم.
وعن المسيح شخصه بذاته.
تعلمت من المسيح أنه هو كل إنسانية ومحبة.
That Jesus is all human love and forgiveness.
وتأثرت به بما أنه بالرغم من أني مسلم.
In spite that I am a Muslim, I was kind of influenced by Jesus Christ and his teachings.
سابقاً ما كنا نعرف شيء عن المسيح.
I didn't know anything before that about Jesus Christ. Before I came to the United States in Iraq, I didn't know anything about Jesus Christ.
لكن من جيت الكنيسة السلام عرفت عنه كل شيء، أنه دين محبة وسلام وتعاون وإنسانية.
So when I came to the United States and came to Salam, I learned a lot about how Christianity is a religion of love and peace. في كلمة أخيرة بتحب تقولها؟
أشكر القس هشام راعي كنيسة السلام على ما يقدمه لنا من المساعدات ودعم وإنهاء أشغالنا الضرورية.
I want to thank Pastor Hisham for all what he does, including the social services and taking care of people who are not able to take care of themselves.
أشكر السيد المسيح لأنه وضع بقلوبهم هذه المحبة.
And I thank Jesus Christ because he put in the heart of his followers this love and humanitarian, spring of love, if I can say. Thank you very much.
Thank
شكراً.
You. شكراً.
نعمل هيك بسبب ال.
Okay.
Thank you very much for being with us today. After Muayyad's interview, I would like to introduce to you our co-worker, Vicar Nader Hanna, who works in California's Orange County, and he has started a mission to Muslims there, where he reaches out to Iranians, Turkish, and Syrian refugees. But before that, if I can say, sermon is taped, so he's not with me today. But I'd like to introduce Messiah for Muslims again, tell you about the story of Messiah for Muslims. In 2007, I drove my daughter to College of DuPage, and she was a student there, and I noticed a poster saying, "Jesus is Muslim. If you want to hear the lecture, come on the day so and so." And so I came to that lecture. They had an apologist from New York City who came, Muslim apologist who came specially for that. And she was giving a lecture trying to prove that Jesus is Muslim and all the teachings of Jesus are of Islam. So I tried to respond, they won't let me, and long story short, I gathered five students and we decided to start a student club called Muslims for the Messiah. So the club survived more than a year, then it joined hands with others and they changed its name. So there is a ministry to Muslims there at College DuPage going on, but under a different name. And so I took that name and filed for a nonprofit. And in 2012, I applied, I got the permission to work under that name. And then later I applied to the Missouri Synod for a recognized service organization. And I was happily approved. And Muslims for the Messiah became an RSO, Recognized Service Organization of the Missouri Synod, Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. I had the pleasure and honor to talk to the Vice President of the Synod, Pastor Nabil Noor, who suggested that I change the name to Messiah for Muslims because it reflects the gospel more, because we do not seek him, he seeks us, we are sinners, and he looks for us and finds us. So Messiah for Muslims reflects the gospel better. So I changed the name to Messiah for Muslims over, even though both names work online. So, to help other missionaries nationwide and sometimes overseas to do this, to do the mission of God to Muslims. Reverend Nader Hanna was one of those friends I met in 2008 when I was teaching a course, actually a short seminar at Horizons International in Boulder, Colorado, and he came specially from Cyprus to attend the seminar, and we became friends, and later we kept in touch, and after some years he came to California and started a mission, and I asked him to join the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, and he agreed after looking at the theology closely and went through the colloquy, and he is soon to be ordained. So I introduce to you Brother Nader Hanna, who's going to give a short sermon today. Thank you very much.
The elephant in the room is the title to my message today. Good morning, church. And yes, you are the church. You don't have to come to the building to be the church. You are the church, the light of the world, the salt of the earth, wherever you are. The elephant in the room. We can just pretend it doesn't exist, but the elephant is not going anywhere. So we might as well look it in the eye and speak to it. And by the elephant, I don't mean the coronavirus. The elephant is the fear surrounding this global crisis. There's no doubt that COVID-19 is a global crisis, the likes of which the world has never seen since World War II. However, fear is causing more damage to individuals, families, societies, nations, economies, much more than the virus itself. Of all people, we, believers and followers of Jesus, have the faith and the courage to face our challenges, problems, and crises with boldness and without fear. Because the worst thing that could happen to us is the best thing that could happen to us. To die and be with Jesus? It's very difficult to scare a person who has that kind of faith and hope. And why we have this hope, and what is our hope founded on? It is because of Palm Sunday, which we're celebrating. God's commandment to Moses and to the people of Israel was to take a one-year-old lamb on the 10th of Nisan. Not that Nisan that you drive. Nisan, the first month in the Jewish calendar. It actually became the first month because of the great salvation the people of Israel experienced in that month, being released from the slavery in Egypt and becoming a free nation with the prospect of having their own land. So this is how they were supposed to celebrate in the years to come. Take a lamb on the 10th of that month, keep it for 4 days until the 14th of the month, which is Passover day, and then kill the lamb and celebrate on the 14th of the month of Nisan. That feast, the feast of Passover, is a prophetic picture of the coming Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So let's look at Jesus' route to the city of Jerusalem. As you know, Jesus had friends in Bethany, Lazarus, Martha, and Mary. And this is where he spent the night. As you can see in the map, Bethany is not far from Jerusalem. When he got to Bethphage, this is where he sent two of his disciples to borrow a donkey. And then he proceeded to the city riding on a donkey. That happened, brothers and sisters, on what we call Palm Sunday, 4 days before Passover day. Jesus entered Jerusalem 4 days before Passover and was kept there. He never left Jerusalem area until the day of Passover. Jesus was keen on entering Jerusalem in the exact way Zechariah the prophet said the Messiah, the King, will enter the city. But what made the religious authorities even more furious was what the multitudes shouted, because they were quoting word for word Psalm 118, a psalm that was reserved only for the Messiah. Hosanna, they shouted. They didn't actually say Hosanna, they shouted Hosanna. That's the Aramaic word they shouted, which means save us, we pray. And they also shouted, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." If you go to Psalm 118, you will find the exact same words. Let me read Psalm 118 and verse 25. "Save us, we pray. Hosanna. O Lord, O Lord, we pray, give us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." The religious authorities asked Jesus later to stop the people. "Don't let them address you with words reserved only for the Messiah." In so many words, Jesus told them, "They're right. I am the Messiah." By entering riding a donkey, and by accepting the multitude's singing and shouting, Jesus declared that he is the Messiah. And by the timing, 4 days before Passover, and staying there, Jesus was declaring that he is the Lamb of God, our Passover Lamb. As a matter of fact, not only Passover, all the feasts of Israel are prophetic, and most of them were fulfilled in and through Jesus. Some are yet to be fulfilled by him in the future. He is our Passover Lamb. The next day after Passover, another 7-day feast started, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Leaven being a symbol of sin. The 7 day of unleavened bread represented the holy and righteous life we live when we believe in the Lamb of God, the Messiah. That's what Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians 5, verses 7 and 8. "Cleanse out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, as you really are unleavened. For Christ, our Passover Lamb, has been sacrificed. Let us therefore celebrate the festival," that is, the festival of unleavened bread, "not with old leaven, the leaven of malice and evil, but with unleavened bread of sincerity and truth." But halfway through these 7-day unleavened bread celebration, there was yet another feast, the Feast of First Fruits. The people were commanded to take a sheaf, a bunch, from the new crop in the field and present it before the Lord. Jesus, faithfully following the prophetic timetable of God, 3 days after Passover and on the day of the first fruits, he rose from the dead. And again, Paul refers to that feast in the same letter to the Corinthians, this time chapter 15 and verse 20. He says, "But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep." That is, those who have died. In other words, Jesus is the first fruit, sheaf, taken from the field. We are the field, the harvest. So if Jesus was taken and presented before God, as in resurrected and ascended to God, we too will be raised, resurrected, and rejoined with God forever. Why should we be fearless? Why do we have this blessed hope? It is because of Palm Sunday. It is because of Palm Sunday. It is because of Passover Friday. It is because of Resurrection Sunday. We have a certain and blessed hope because of the Savior who presented himself 4 days before Passover, was crucified on Passover day and resurrected 3 days later on the day of the first fruits. I'm telling you, it's very difficult to scare someone who has that kind of hope. So, is the elephant still there? I don't know about you, but the elephant is nowhere to be found here. Fear cannot survive in the presence of love. There is no fear in love, says St. John. And we've been given so much love. We know God is our loving Heavenly Father, who protects and provides for us, and who makes everything work for the good of those who love Him. We're not afraid to die. For to me, to live is Christ, says St. Paul, and to die is gain. Fear has no place in our life, because God has given us His Spirit. Jesus said, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Fear has no place in our life, says Paul, for God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of power and love and sound mind. Well, having no fear, we're free to worship. We're free to pray. We're free to think and come up with all kinds of ideas to serve our families, friends, neighbors, and the world, free to respond to the current crisis in a way that gives glory to God and gives hope and provide the help people around us are so desperate for. So let me give you a few suggestions of things that you and I can do these days. First and foremost, if you haven't put your trust in Jesus, do it now. Even if you've been going to church all your life, we will be with God forever, not because we perform religious duties, but because we're His family. If you're not sure you're a part of God's family, have a heart-to-heart talk with Him. Repent of your sins and of your self-righteousness. Receive what God has to give you for free. Faith, forgiveness for your sins, eternal life, and the gift of the Holy Spirit. All because of what Jesus did on Palm Sunday, Passover Friday, and Resurrection Sunday. Take refuge in God. Let Him be your fortress, your hiding place. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High, says the psalmist, will abide in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge, my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Put your trust in Jesus and in Him alone for this life and the life to come. Number two, pray. Church, let us not be a Jonah. Jonah hid himself from the Lord and from the Word in time of crisis. Jonah waited until the pagan sailors asked him, when are you going to cry out for your God? We cried out each to his God. Church, darkness is not a time for the church to hide. Darkness is a time for the church to arise and shine. Let us rather be Daniels who turn our face to the Lord God, seeking Him by prayer and pleas for mercy. Daniel 9:3. Cry out with Daniel, O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, pay attention and act. Delay not for your own sake. Oh my God, Daniel 9:19. This whole chapter, Daniel 9, is your homework. Read it, or rather, pray it over and over again. Everybody is doing their bit to combat the virus, to flatten the curve, to help the infected. It is time for us to do our bit. We have a weapon that the rest of the world does not have. We have the name which is above all name, power and authority. We have access to the very throne room of God Himself. We can have a hearing with Him any time of the day or the night. Let us then, with confidence, draw near to the throne of grace so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. And this is a time of need. Faith does not ignore the facts. It overwrites them with the truth. Let us face the grim facts of this pandemic with the unchanging truth of the Word of God. Jesus said we can speak to mountains and command them to throw themselves in the sea. Let us speak to the mountains of despair and drown them in the sea of faith. Number three, be a voice of peace and hope to your family, friends, and community. Reach out to people over the phone, FaceTime, Zoom, whatever you have and you can use. Be there for people and provide a much needed encouragement and hope. Number four, be prepared, says Apostle Paul, Peter. Always be prepared, he says, to give an answer, to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. There are people in whose hearts the Holy Spirit is working right now, and they're looking for answers. Be prepared to lead them to Jesus. Finally, find ways to share the love of God with those around you in practical ways. Apostle John says, you show love for others by truly helping them and not merely by talking about it. For so God loved the world that He gave. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving of your time, talent, and treasure. May the Savior, who became one of us, who presented Himself on Palm Sunday like a lamb that is led to slaughter, be your strength, refuge, and hope. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.